Good evening, everybody, and thank you for coming. I'm going to talk for about 50 minutes or so. Can you all hear me okay? Is that mic working? All right, that's all okay. My paper for you this evening is concerned with Britain's coastal anti-invasion landscapes of the Second World War. I find these rather interesting, but even I would admit it's not the most glamorous of subjects, even within fortification studies, and it carries with it the dubious connotations of a subject fit only for those with an unhealthy interest in pillbox typology. There's also, I think, a preconception that there's no room for archaeology here. It's the Second World War, the documents will tell you everything you need to know. Well, I hope to kind of change some of this a bit for you this evening by relating some of the findings of the programme of research that I've been doing at UEA. And my paper is one of two halves. In the first half, I want to talk about some of the findings of fieldwork and documentary research. In the second part of my paper, I want to kind of offer up some wider interpretations concerning the cultural significance of Second World War defences more generally. But the subject, of course, is not new. Much work was undertaken by the organisation formerly known as English Heritage and the CBA. Those organisations really put this subject on the academic map some 50 years ago now. Much of this work has been published, much of it hasn't. But it's really from this work that my paper this evening takes its lead, and really sort of jumping off from that point, probably the best way into this subject is to start with this comment, this observation by Colin Dobinson in an unpublished report of 1996, basically saying that Britain's anti-invasion defences of the Second World War were established in 1940, extended in 1941, adapted in 1942, maintained in 1943, and in part dismantled from mid-1944. Now, that is true. There is nothing that I'm going to say this evening which is going to really question that. But I would say this is the national picture, and this is an observation which comes from the analysis of documents of headquarters, higher form formations, that kind of thing. And therefore, it's an observation which is more applicable the further up the chain of command you go. Now, Dobinson kind of said this in his report, and one of the recommendations for future work was the production of detailed local and regional case studies to see how much of this was actually applicable on the ground, and that's what I want to do this evening. But really, by way of introduction, Blitzkrieg, the German opening of the war in the West in May 1940, followed by the rapid capitulation of France and the Low Countries, precipitated what was probably the most significant invasion crisis in modern British history. One response to those events was the fortification of the coastline, principally in 1940 and 1941, and the establishment of a coastal defence zone from which civilians were either encouraged to leave or were excluded entirely. The fortification of the coastline at this time must count as one of the largest construction projects in modern British history, and I think probably represents the greatest single visual change to the UK coastline than at any time since, I would think. Perhaps wind farms will change that, but I think if we exclude wind farms, I think the changing visual nature of the coastline at this time, but because of this, is quite important. And there you can see some coastal defences being built, some after they've been built. You can see some disappointed schoolgirls who can't get on the beach, and there you can see a cunningly camouflaged pillbox, camouflaged as an ice cream kiosk, which 70 years on still works, in as much as I showed this to one of my undergraduates a couple of weeks ago, and they said, "Oh, why did they need ice creams on the beach if it was being defended?" It still works, kind of 70 years on. Now, thanks to the work of people like Dobinson and William Foote, the place of these coastal defences within the broader national strategy of defence is well known. This is the man with Mission Impossible in 1940, summer of 1940, General Edmund Ironside. The BEF has come back from Dunkirk, it's exhausted, it's left most of its modern equipment behind. What Ironside instigates is very much a kind of strategy that's based on holding up any foreign invasion at every turn. And it really consists of a number of different elements. The first element is what we call the coastal crust. The fortification of the coastline all the way from Scotland down to Cornwall, not designed to throw any invaders back into the sea, but rather to hold them up for as long as possible. Once those invading forces get inland, they are going to be held up at every turn. Road junctions, bottlenecks in the road network, and vulnerable points, these sorts of things were fortified in what were called nodal points, and these nodal points were themselves joined up by anti-tank barriers known as stop lines, which is what you can see on the map there on the right, which are intended to corral any invading forces, hold them up for as long as possible. Once it is known where the main enemy incursion is, there's going to be a last final pitch battle by what's left of Britain's mobile grid reserves, and the enemy will be defeated. Or at least that's the plan. As Ironside put it, it's a strategy that's based on linear defence, and as he said, it was designed to prevent the enemy from running riot and tearing the guts out of the country, as happened in France and Belgium. Very famous quote from his diaries there. So that's 1940. As we moved actually from 1940 into 1941, there's a change in the high command. Field Marshal Sir Alan Brooke becomes Commander-in-Chief Home Forces. He reorganises coastal defences, principally in 1941. There's a greater emphasis on mobile reserves, partly because he's actually got them, and troops on the coast are reorganised into what are called forward defended localities with defence in depth. And that's what you can see there. It doesn't matter, that's a military map, it doesn't matter what all this stuff is, other than to say that this is a forward defended locality surrounded by its barbed wire and its defensive. There's an emphasis on all-round defence rather than a linear static defence. And the buzzword in 1941 is static linear defence should be stamped out. Beware the Maginot mindset. You know, a reference to the French defences which had failed so spectacularly in 1940. Now the archaeological legacy of 1940 and 1941 is considerable. The Defence of Britain project in the 1990s identified some 5,000 anti-invasion sites. Principally, we think about the gun batteries you can see up there, we think about the pillboxes, we might think about spigot mortars, but also there's a very important earthwork legacy here as well, such as you can see here, that's an anti-tank ditch. It's also, I think, this period have left us with an interesting cultural legacy, best summed up, I think, by these people. Don't tell your name, Pike. From the 1970s, this is something that we can laugh at, that we can poke fun at. I would just say it sort of at this juncture that humour was not the sentiment at the forefront of the mind of the commanding officer of the 7th Manchesters at Lowestoft in Suffolk, who on the 9th of July 1940 wrote in his battalion war diary the record of events that his unit was taking part in. Here we find ourselves suddenly on what is actually the front line, and at any moment we may have to fight and stay fighting. No withdrawal. You really get a sense there of kind of the coastline is the front line. And again, humour wasn't, I think, at the forefront of the mind of the anonymous person who scratched on the wet concrete of an embrasure on this pillbox here in the summer of 1940, there'd always be in England. So it's something in the post-war period we find kind of laughable, something for kind of humour. That's not really kind of the kind of sentiment that you get from the contemporary evidence. And I would say Britain's coastal defences are planned in some detail, often by very senior officers from the Royal Engineers. They were also taken very, very seriously by the Germans, who spent a considerable amount of time photographing, listing them, categorising them for their own purposes. So they were very much taken seriously. And most of what I want to kind of talk about for the rest of my paper comes from one study area. It's a kind of what's known as a sector. The whole of the coastline was divided up for military purposes into sectors. This is a sector which effectively encompasses the modern county of Suffolk. This is a wartime map, and you can see the sector is divided up into subsectors. And it shows the coastal defences quite nicely, in as much as you have the coastal crust, the obstacles which are kind of listed running down the coast. You have the first of the stop lines, what's known as the back line, inland from the invasion beaches, and all those circles that you can see there are these fortified nodal points, junctions where any invading army can be held up. A division is the kind of lowest formation in the British Armed Forces, where you have an all-arms capability. You've got infantry, engineers, artillery, and that kind of thing. At this period, we're talking about 20,000 men. You've got about 20,000 men defending that sector, certainly in 1940. And in terms of the work that we've been doing, we've done systematic field survey of that coastal zone. We've also looked at all of the war diaries for the principal, all the principal war diaries for all the units and formations stationed within that sector over the course of the whole war. Those are contemporary records, or very near contemporary records, telling us what those units are actually up to. So that's the kind of the broad kind of context, the broad picture. In terms of the obstacles, they are well known in their own right to kind of archaeologists who kind of study these things. Most of the archaeology is associated with holding up the invaders, especially vehicles. And you have the ubiquitous anti-tank blocks or anti-tank cubes, sometimes called anti-tank traps, that you can see there, designed to impede the passage of trapped vehicles. Anti-tank scaffolding that you can see there for the same purpose. You've got roadblocks, you can see there. You've got the ubiquitous barbed wire laid, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of kilometres of barbed wire laid in England at this time. And there you've got what are called dragon's teeth, and spikes stuck in the waterline intended to take the bottom out of any landing barges as they actually hit the beach. What I should say is all of these have their own distinctive archaeologies, which are kind of almost a separate paper in its own right. But, for example, anti-tank blocks are often found either in very, very long lines to block the passage of vehicles as they land on beaches. In other times, they are kind of put laterally along beaches in order to stop lateral movement up and down them, or they're there to block obvious exit points, and much the same is for barbed wire. So they all have their own, if you like, archaeologies. Also, inland from the beaches, you have other forms of obstacle, chiefly anti-tank ditches or anti-landing ditches. This is Sutton Common in 1944. You can see the whole thing is kind of crisscrossed with anti-landing ditches. Sutton Hoo, of course, very famously has one of these dug in 1941 across the site, which is now known, you know, now part of the kind of heritage, now part of the archaeology of the site. So you have these sorts of things just inland from the invasion beaches as well. But really, these obstacles have to be manned, and the mainstay of the defence of Britain's beaches lies with the infantry. And their activities are best seen in the use and the distribution of these things, concrete pillboxes, hardened field fortifications. And when I started work on this, I thought, okay, pillboxes, and it's the kind of thing that I'm always kind of puzzled, well, how do they actually work? You know, I kind of imagined that you have lots of people held up in them, you know, and that didn't really seem to make a great deal of sense. Of course, the answer is, in many cases, particularly when it comes to the coastal crust, we've lost the immediate landscape context of these monuments. And the immediate landscape contexts are fieldworks, trench systems, which actually go with the pillboxes and which were actually quite substantial in their nature. This is a fantastic photograph, it's a propaganda photograph taken in 1940 of Great Yarmouth. There you can see obviously the pillbox in the background with its rudimentary camouflage, and you can see the very extensive network of trenches which actually come off that pillbox, and where you can see most of the Tommies doing their drills. Now, this completely changes your perception of the monument when you kind of put the immediate landscape context back into it. And in a small number of cases, these trench systems actually survive as earthworks. This is a place called Hoyse Covert near Walswick in Suffolk. There's the pillbox, and there you can see very clearly, partially filled in, the remains of the communication trench that originally connected that pillbox with a much larger fire trench. And for each basic 10-man infantry section, the idea was at any one time only two men would be in the pillbox. The remaining eight would actually be in the trenches outside the pillbox, unless there was an air raid, in which case they were all allowed to kind of get in. But these things, if this was Roman, if this was medieval, we would be very, very interested in it. This dates from the summer of 1940, it's abandoned in 1941. There are a handful of these that I know about in Norfolk and Suffolk. They're very, very rare. And certainly I think they need to be on our radar as archaeology. And we did some computer reconstruction of this Hoyse Covert system, which I want to show you, because it gives quite a nice example of how these things actually look. So that's the pillbox. Part of the reason it survives those trenches is because it was covered in woodland after 1945. And this shows a mythical scene about 6:30 in the morning in September 1940, stand to. These are men from the 2nd 4th South Lancashire Regiment who were there at the time. We excavated this trench to get the dimensions. We excavated the door lock, someone had put a door in there, so we put a little Art Deco door in. And here we go down. We have excavated evidence for a fire step, and this is almost something that resembles what we might think of as a First World War trench system. There's definitely a fire step. We excavated the remains of the posts that held the trench walls up. There's sand here, and you're in that communication trench now, and you're going to go round, and you're going to go into the pillbox, which raises an interesting question. What did you find in the pillbox in 1940? It's an incredibly difficult question to answer. So we did what most people do. We put a few stores in, we put spare rifles, we put some haversacks, that sort of thing, a couple of spare helmets. Typical 1940, there's no internal ricochet wall, so if a bullet had gone in, it would have bounced around, probably killed the occupants. This is the archaeology of Rush, better to have something rather than nothing. And that's the trench system at Stand 2. I wanted to have one of the Tommies having a crafty cigarette before children are going to watch this, so we probably can't have that. And there you can see going over the top of the trench, the infantry section. So that kind of gives you kind of quite a nice visual idea, I think, of the sorts of things that we've been talking about. So you've got the obstacles, you've got the infantry. What we have, I think, managed to do in our work is actually raise the profile of the last element of the coastal crust, which I think is something that has been missing from established narratives, and that's the provision for field artillery in coastal defence. What I mean by that is these are batteries of field guns that are placed inland behind the invasion beaches and which were intended to shell those beaches in the event of an attack or an invasion. Now this is a very, very busy map, but it's actually really quite simple to understand, in as much as you have back here inland, these are the positions of the field guns, which normally go in groups of four. You can see the arcs of fire there, they overlap, so basically all parts of the coast can have artillery barrages put down on them. Those red marks, which some of them are on the coast and some of them are out into the sea, these are what are called SOS or DF, direct fire tasks, and that is where spotters on the coast can actually radio back or telephone back pre-registered targets so that the gunners behind the lines can then immediately fire on them. This information was relayed back by spotters who had their own concrete observation posts. These are often mistaken for infantry pillboxes, but they aren't. They are for the Royal Artillery, and they are for spotters looking out over the coast in order to spot targets. When one of those targets moves into one of the direct fire zones, they can pick up the field telephone and go SOS task one, or whatever it happens to be, and literally in minutes, shells can be brought down onto that particular bit of the coastline. There's kind of been an assumption, I think, in the secondary literature that field artillery doesn't leave any archaeological trace. That is simply not true, as evidenced by this remarkable site near Southwold, which we turned up. A farmer phoned me up one day and said, "I hear you're interested in Second World War coastal defence stuff." I said, "Yes." And he said, "Well, I've got some stuff on my land that's supposed to do with the coast, but we're 4 miles inland, so it can't be." I said, "Well, it might be." So I turned up expecting to see a bit of concrete rubble. No, we had a complete troop position for 4 field guns. 26, I think, concrete structures. 4 gun houses, lockers for ammunition, air raid shelters behind, crew shelters, the remains of missing huts, and ammunition lockers behind. This has been left alone since 1942 when the site was abandoned. We had to clear the whole thing with chainsaws and that kind of thing. A complete preserved troop position from 1940 and 1941, all given concrete protection, probably in the winter of 1940-1941, around January time. An extraordinary archaeological survival, and I would say, you know, the archaeology, you know, field artillery certainly does leave archaeological trace, and that site is the best example of it, I think. Now, those are the elements that make up the coastal crust in 1940-1941, and they are reasonably well known. But I think what's much more interesting is the process by which they were actually configured on the ground, because the generals may well have had their schemes, but the archaeology shows the extent to which, if at all, those schemes were actually realised by the people on the ground. And the relationship between landscape and defence planning is best illustrated by Subsector 3, I think, which if we go to this one, put that map up again. The subsector 3 is basically the strip of coastline between Southwold and Aldeburgh in central Suffolk. And you're looking south at the moment there. You're up on, you're right on the east coast, you're at Dunwich here, you're looking south towards Sizewell, which is nicely picked out by the power station there. This is kind of typical East Anglia. Yeah? You've got landscape of cliffs, it's long open beach and marshland. That's actually RSPB Minsmere down there, so Springwatch and those sorts of things, you know, now the very important nature reserve. And the military, obviously, are very interested in the topography. And what they say about the topography in this particular part of Suffolk is this. There are certain well-defined spurs, Aldeburgh, Thorpeness, Sizewell, Dunwich and Walberswick, along which run the main approaches inland and are divided from one another by marshy areas and cliffs where the streams run into the sea. This formation will necessitate the capture of the spurs by an invader before ingress inland on a large scale can be made. It therefore lends itself to defence by strong locations on the spurs, the intervening marshes being made as impassable as possible. So basically what you don't want are the Germans landing on Sizewell Beach, driving inland, turning left and making on London. Where you've got the marshland behind the beaches, you can flood it, or you can make it impassable very, very easily. So you defend the areas that you have to defend. You use nature or other means to protect the areas that are less vulnerable. And you can translate those sorts of documents into maps like this that shows the whole of the subsector. And you've got the vulnerable beaches here, you've got the less vulnerable beaches and cliffs here, and these are the marshy areas that you can flood or prepare for flooding if you have to. When you put the pillboxes and the artillery observation post on, what you find, as you might expect, nonetheless it's interesting to do, clusterings of pillboxes on those vulnerable beaches and protecting the main vulnerable roads inland. So Sizewell, you can see there, you know, very vulnerable beach, has a large population of pillboxes. In the areas that are flooded, obviously you don't need so many, you get virtually nil. But this is where you have the long rows of anti-tank blocks, the long rows of dragon's teeth, scaffolding, that kind of thing, because you can effectively cut off this coastline, segregate it according to how vulnerable you think the defences are. And inland, particularly when it comes to those vulnerable roads, those are the areas that you cut off with anti-tank ditches and anti-landing ditches. And there are several myths associated with this kind of stuff. One of the myths is when you see a pillbox facing inland, it's been placed the wrong way around. You know, that's not actually the case, because the fear is that what will happen is that there will be a landing by paratroops, troops landed by glider behind the invasion beaches, and the invasion beaches will be taken from both sides at once. Hence, you need to have pillboxes facing inland as well as out to the sea. And you get some sense of how this would have worked. Fantastic photograph taken a few years ago after a major flood, showing part of subsector 3. That's Walberswick up there, that's Dunwich down here. These are the spurs, look. Those are the bits with the roads. These are the bits that you can flood or prepare for flooding. And that gives you some sense of what the wartime landscape might actually look like and how they're actually planning to defend it. Now, at this point, you would say, okay, military defences are directly related to the topography. Well, you don't have to be Bonaparte to work that one out, do you? That's kind of fairly obvious. Yeah? Nothing new there, but I suppose I would say this sort of analysis has been done for prehistoric defences, it's been done for Roman defences, a lot of time recently been done on castles, that sort of thing. This type of analysis still hasn't really been done for the UK's coastal defence landscape. But I think you can take it one stage further, because without in any way starting a kind of structure or agency debate, these defences may well be mediated through the physical topography. Of course they are. But they're also mediated by human decisions, a decision-making process, by an organisation with a rigid organisational structure and command structure. In this particular case, you had officers on the ground who were being told, effectively, by Ironside and Alan Brooke, that they have to do this, they have to do that. Well, in this particular case, I think you can see where the human agency actually starts to kind of work with the landscape. And the critical point in the chain of command seems to be at brigade level and battalion level. That's at subsector level, effectively. We're talking about colonels, brigadiers, sometimes majors. Now, these are individuals that are often hidden from us because they aren't the kind of officers who have private papers that end up in King's College London in the Little Heart Archive. They're kind of almost invisible to us. And we see their decisions, I would argue, in the archaeology, and we only obliquely see them in the war diaries, in the documents. You get things like this. Commanding officer went round the brigade area and sighted new positions. Conference of commanding officers and company commanders on Sizewell Beach to discuss arrangements for anti-tank ditch. You know, that's all you get in the documentary sources. And this, I think, is the point where that top-down planning, Ironside, Alan Brooke, meets the physical reality on the ground. People have got to translate their orders into some kind of defence system on the ground. And that's the moment, I think, or the point at which it happens. And clearly they are making their own decisions. They are not simply building in a very straightforward way what the command, high command want them to. And I would argue very strongly that the defences I've been talking about are as much bottom-up as they are top-down. In as much as, if we go north to Warberswick, I like that I've been shot for showing this in public in 1940, here's a map of the dispositions of C Company, the 2nd, 4th South Lancashire Regiment. Each one of these little things here represents a 10-man infantry section on the ground. Notice it's linear, it's long. This is the sort of thing that we associate with Ironside, static, linear defence. Well, we know when this was put in, between the 10th and the 12th of May 1940. Ironside had nothing to do with it. Yeah? This was the invasion panic. The Germans are streaming over the border into the Low Countries in France. The men on the ground do what they think they should do, is they concentrate and they start to build these positions. All Ironside did was to facilitate the building of the concrete structures later on in the summer of 1940. That arrangement, which looked very Ironside-y, has got nothing to do with it. That's the result of the commanding officer of that particular battalion doing his own thing. Equally, that kind of move to all-round defence that I talked about, and Alan Brooke. Well, in subsector 4, south of the one we've been looking at, this is a map of positions taken from war diaries and from the archaeology. You can't really move to all-round defence because the topography won't let you. It doesn't make any sense. You can't really do it. So in 1941, you've actually still, particularly here, very much got a linear 1940 type arrangement, simply because it's more or less impossible to do anything else. You only get a little bit close to it up here, and that is in part because you've got the bend of the Butley River actually affecting the decision-making process. So clearly what's happening here is individuals on the ground are making their own choices about how they're going to interpret their orders, and I think that's really something which is quite interesting. And in brief, just to kind of round that off, in the second half of the war, this defence landscape very much becomes a training landscape. And from 1943, you start to see the appearance on the coast of training infrastructure. This is training for overlord, training for a return to northwestern Europe. This is a fantastic place, Boyton Marsh in East Suffolk. This is a tank gunnery range from 1945 air photograph. That little perimeter there is where the tanks went round and round and round on the move. The crews had to practice firing on the move at targets that were towed along these earthwork banks here. So the crews had to get used to shooting on the move while targets that are on the move. And a great deal of concrete infrastructure goes with it. From 1943 onwards, you start to get larger exercises with a very distinct purpose. This is one from the spring of 1943, Exercise Christian. This was one of the first exercises to inform the planning of D-Day. And in order to practice their tactical drills, a complete mock German landscape known as a hedgehog was actually built on Dunwich Heath in the coastal defence zone, upon which troops practiced on it. So there you can see a replica German concrete fortification that's been blown up. There you can see replica German field works and underground chambers which troops actually practiced on. And as well as that, some of our pill boxes, only a couple of years old, were reused for target practice. That's the hoist cover pill box I told you we've seen earlier. You've got the bullet scabbing there where it's used as a target during a mock attack, probably in 1943 or 1944. That is a blown up pill box near Lowestoft, and you sort of get things in war diaries from from 1943 onwards like this. Troops marched to and from Hitler pillbox near Dulwich, which was blown up by Wade's and beehives. Those are the explosive devices that they're using. So this coastal defence landscape is very, very short-lived, but it's reworked as a training landscape almost as soon as it's finished, which I find quite interesting. And this is my favourite sort of training slide. It's a kind of then and now, in as much as that's near Aldborough. And that is a drainage ditch in the marsh, widened to make an anti-tank obstacle in 1941, being reused in 1943 as a part of an infantry training for Operation Overlord. And you can see the exact spot on the ground where the cameraman was taking his photo when you go there. It's quite spooky, actually. Now that's hopefully of kind of moderate kind of interest. For the next sort of 20 minutes or so, I want to kind of broaden this out and try to not just talk about pillboxes and concrete and that sort of thing, but try to put this into the context of the social landscape of the Second World War. And here what I want to do is to draw some points of comparison and points of contrast with the other great fortification project of the Second World War, the building of the Atlantic Wall by the Axis powers. And here you can see the remains of a German battery just outside of Dunkirk. And now, of course, in terms of archaeological preservation and heritage, this represents all kinds of problems and interests for people in the countries that were formerly occupied, because these are monuments to contestation, occupation, collaboration. They were frequently built by local contractors who were paid. What do you do with them now? What do they represent? That's actually quite difficult. Now, what I should say, of course, and everything I'm going to say from this point on needs to be seen within this context, those fortifications were built by an armed forces as part of its drive to consolidate its territorial gains. The defences in Britain were, of course, built by a home army attempting to protect itself and its sovereignty from foreign invasion. That is an obvious point of contrast. Another point of contrast, as we will see, is that the Axis powers will quite happily knock down a medieval town in order to put their anti-tank ditch exactly where they want. As we'll see in a moment, not quite the same sort of thing in Britain. But I would point out, because the military technology is basically the same for both sides, there is a commonality to the infrastructure and to the archaeology. German anti-tank obstacle, British anti-tank obstacle. German anti-landing craft obstacle, British anti-landing craft obstacle. Battery observation post at Felixstowe, battery observation post at Ostend. You know, there is a certain commonality here that I think we need to be aware of. We also need to be aware of the fact that the British state appropriates it for itself powers during wartime under Defence Regulation 51 and 52, which means the military effectively have a free hand as far as the defence of the realm is concerned. So basically, if the military say, I want to requisition your house because it overlooks the beach and I want to put a pillbox in it, there's nothing you can do about it. You will get paid compensation, but there's nothing you can do about it. And that, I think, is kind of worth knowing. Because the dislocation effect of the sorts of rather the dislocation that the building of fortifications during the Second World War has on East Anglia, in this particular case Suffolk, is considerable. And here, very quickly, we need to bear in mind the pre-war perception of the landscape I've been talking about. This is quintessential East Anglia, where the sea meets the sky, muted terrain, open beaches. It's a place that's well known as a haunt for artists. It's got a certain melancholia to it. It's also very spooky. This is one of the haunts of Black Shuck, the black devil dog of East Anglia. Don't look into his eyes, anybody, because you'll die within a year and a day if you do. Whistle and I'll come to thee, my lad. Almost spooky. Yeah, that's set in this particular part of the world. M.R. James drew a great deal of inspiration from this part of the world. Unsurprisingly, in 1940, you start to create that military landscape. People think about it and they're moved. And they're moved to write about it. This is a wonderful award-winning book, actually, by Michael Foreman, War Boy, which is a very kind of nostalgic autobiographical account of growing up in this landscape as a child during the war and what it actually meant. Children's Corner, Lowestoft. No child set foot on the beach for the duration of the war. That's not true, as we'll see in a moment. Yeah, but closed beaches, the beaches are closed. They write about it. Now, they also are moved to write poetry. Now, this is not great verse, but it's better than I can do. here you have, you know, Adams and Adams, Walberswick, then and now, about 1943. The bridges had all disappeared, the sluices turned about to keep the water on the marsh, which always kept it out. The beach is barricaded now, the lanes are mud and mire, the footpaths and the lovely walks are strewn with barbed wire. Big guns firing all around, shells burst with all their might, and aeroplanes overhead are flying day by day and night. Oh, Walberswick, I don't despair, good times will come again, when war is done and peace declared, prosperity will reign. Now, it may not be Wordsworth, as I said, it's better than I can do. You've almost got a binary opposition there between the peacetime landscape and the wartime landscape, which is very interesting. Now, I'm in real trouble here because I'm not an art historian, and I notice there are historians in the room, so I'm going to be very, very careful when I do this. When we come to look at works of art, you can contrast Bertram Priestman's Walberswick Marshes, which mine aren't due tonight, looks like the kind of very nice kind of English landscape painting of the interwar period, eulogising the peaceful landscape. What a difference from the Southwold artist Prynne Clough, Closed Beach, 1945, using the coastal defences as inspiration for what's a very bleak, jarring composition, which is more surrealist, it's more, much more avant-garde for the time, certainly not with popular taste. And I think when you actually see the defences, this is what I start to call the disruptive narrative. And if you're a phenomenologist, this is a dream topic for me, because you can emphasise the binary opposition between peacetime and wartime. You can talk about alien structures being placed down into this landscape. The very thing that this landscape was eulogised for, the long open beaches and so forth, this is exactly what the military do not want in 1940. They want a bounded, corralled landscape where they can bring the enemy in and dispatch them exactly where they want them. You can take it further. You can also say, well, the very geometric forms of the anti-tank blocks and the pill blocks are alien to this landscape. And the way in which the geometry divides the landscape up is disruptive and dislocates people. And when you see some of these things in the flesh, you can understand why there might be mileage in that view. That's Felix though in 1944. A real mess. And you can even go to the Mass Observation Survey, which, as you know, is the government snooping agency in the war, paying people to go into pubs and listen on conversations to see what people really think about the war. One of their observers goes to Alba in 1940 and he says this: depression in Alba would seem to a large extent to be directly due to economic facts. The economic basis of Alba life is the summer holiday season, and this has been wiped out. Even the local golf club is shut down. No one is allowed near the beach, which is covered with obstructions, the cause of much unfavourable comment from the civilians, who wonder whether it will ever be possible to make the beach look nice again. When you see that, you can understand why. But this is where the disruptive narrative starts to run out, or rather you can only take it so far, because the observer also says this: plenty of people have left the town, and some have returned again. Those who have never left express frequent contempt for the others, or show a feeling of superiority towards them. This gives a group strength which is helpful in maintaining people's spirits. Considering that the town is now perhaps one of the quietest and dullest places in Britain, the degree of depression and irritation in Alba is not remarkably high. That's two sides of the same coin, that one. You can pick a mix with that one. It's interesting, it's you can only take this so far, and there are reasons why we can only take this so far, I think. The first one is actual evidence for direct contestation between the military and the civilians is incredibly rare. Without trying to buy into the myth of the Blitz and the rest of it, it's incredibly difficult to find. This is one of the few examples we've actually got it in a war diary from the summer of 1940. C Company forwarded message that local police inspector reported there would likely be trouble from the Kessingland fishermen as slipways onto the beach had been removed to form a field of fire. Interesting, the local Bobby is reporting that. I suspect it was that pillbox, actually, that was causing the trouble, because that's for a Vickers machine gun, which needs a very, very long field of fire and was probably adjacent to where the fishermen had their slipways. So contestation is actually rare. Secondly, and we forget about this, and with the centenary of the First World War, this is quite opposite, because I think we've forgotten the extent to which the coastline was militarised in the First World War, because it's not as archaeologically visible as the Second. And yet, you've got First World War pillboxes, that's Felixstowe in 1917, considerable numbers of these were built. Here you have a Second World War battery post overlooking a First World War pillbox. The East Anglians have seen their coastline be militarised already. The sorts of places that were militarised in the First World War, and indeed the Napoleonic Wars, were also militarised in the Second World War. And one very good day in the office, looking through the headquarters papers of Eastern Command in 1940, there were all kind of memos going back. What do the civvies think? We've just moved 20,000 men up to the coast. There's no trouble from the East Anglians. They've seen it all before in the last war. I think that's a really kind of useful thing. There's an antecedent structure here. Secondly, our humble pillboxes are not as alien as we might imagine, partly because there are lots of First World War ones still knocking about. Secondly, look at that pillbox, which is made of prefabricated concrete blocks, which come from a brickworks at the nearby Ogilvy Estate. The same brickworks that built the Ogilvy Estate village, the interwar holiday resort of Thorpe Ness, which it looks like kind of Tudor-y, Mockney kind of timber framing. Behind that timber cladding are concrete blocks like this that you can see in the gardens and the walls of Thorpe Ness Holiday Village. That is the entrance to the tennis club. Geometric concrete blocks. These are a garden wall. That looks like it could even be a loopholed wall. It's not, it's a garden wall. So the actual appearance of the pillbox is not quite as revolutionary as we might imagine. Also the case, localism in defence works. This is a time of national invasion. East Anglians are invested in their own defences. That's the coastal battery at Aldborough, built by Reeds, the principal builders in Aldborough before the war. They get paid £1,500 per battery. And we know from their ledger the government pays them a year late. They get their money. These anti-tank rocks on Walterswick Beach, we know, were built by the local builders, great for anti-tank cubes. They were called block builders, which I just think is brilliant. They had one petrol-driven cement mixer, we know this from oral history, that was brought out to the beach. The men of the village physically went out, took shingle off the beach in order to mix up the concrete for those anti-tank blocks. So they're literally building it themselves. And they're also heavily involved in the Home Guard as well. So there is a, if you like, a local and regional stake in the building of these defences. And there are, and I talked about the level of sort of decision making in terms of the building of the defence landscape. There are also clearly very careful arrangements put in place to coexist, or rather, for the military side of things, has to coexist with the demand from agriculture. So I talked about flooding of marshes, which indeed some of them were. Some of them, a large proportion of them weren't. They were prepared for flooding, but very complex arrangements were set down as to when the sluices could be opened so the water could actually inundate them. And it's almost as if the first landing barge has to hit the beach before the local bobby goes down and opens the sluices, because they're desperate for the agricultural production to continue. And naively, when I started this project and I thought about anti-tank ditches, how do you do an anti-tank ditch? I presumed some of the top brass get a map. They decide the best place to put an anti-tank ditch, they draw it and they go, right, off you go, go and do it. Well, they don't. What they do is there is some kind of level of that kind of planning, but they devolve it down to the local units, who all build their own little section at different times, and it ends up being joined up. If you think about it, it's how we think prehistoric banks and ditches were built, and also how Hadrian's Wall was built. And best of all, anti-tank ditches work like parish boundaries do, in as much as parish boundaries tend to run straight over open areas because there's nothing for them to follow. The moment they hit a worked agricultural landscape, they tend to kink round field boundaries and that sort of thing. Here's an aerial photograph from 1944. Just look at how this anti-tank ditch works. It's running across heath here, so it's relatively straight. That's fine. Relatively straight. Okay. Now we're hitting the agricultural landscape. Kink, follow the field boundary. Kink, follow the field boundary. We're now into a patch of heath. Straight across the heath, that's absolutely fine. Now we're going to hit a road. Kink, up there. Now we're approaching a road junction. Can't mess that up. So we kink round it, leaving the road system intact. And there are other examples as well where the road, an anti-tank ditch will go up to a farmhouse, go around it, and continue again. That's a real point of contrast with the sorts of things that are going on in the Atlantic Wall. And for all those reasons, these are the sorts of say, local decisions that are being made actually on the ground. And best of all is this one, how close to the beaches really? Because in talking, doing a lot of oral history, talking to local history groups, always in the questions, you said the beaches were closed, that I can remember swimming on the beach during the war. I said, are you sure it was the wall? Well, I was on one of those anti-tank blocks and my swimming teacher made me do breaststroke on top of the anti-tank block. Are you sure it was the wall? And one lady from the Overly estate more or less said, young man, I know it was the wall because I can remember waving to the soldiers on my way down to the beach and then waving back. And I remember it was the war because my mother said I must keep to the path because there's a minefield on the other side. I just imagine my kids going, right, stay on the path, you know, coming like that. And this, and there was too much of this coming out. Go back to the documents, go back to the sources, and so forth. And yes, the beaches were closed for those people who weren't in the coastal defence zone, but for those that were, gaps were left in the defences. Partly so the inshore lifeboats could continue to operate, partly so the inshore fishing industry could carry on, and partly so people could still go swimming. And this was done in full expectations that the Germans would see it from the air, and if they wanted to launch a raid, they would actually use them. And the deals went like this. Fishermen want to go out, the fishermen have to say, this is when we're going out, this is when we're coming back. The troops, okay, that's fine, out you go, out they come in. But the deal was, the troops have a share of the catch. And there's a litany of these little negotiations that we've come across, which I think ameliorates the worst, if you like, military excesses of the defence landscape. So how close is close? That's Lowestoft in 1944. There you can see beach defences, lots of people in uniform. What's that behind? People on the beach bathing. That's what we've got there. But overarching on this, I'm realising I've got 4 minutes, which is fine. Underpinning all of this is what I call the threat, or the consciousness of war. And in recent years, there's been a lot of discussion about this sort of thing in the press, UK involvement in Afghanistan and in Iraq, and the extent to which the consciousness of war at home doesn't match the intensity of the fighting abroad. In terms of the Second World War, I will state the obvious, but it's worth stating, the consciousness of war is extremely high. For obvious reasons. Because an invasion never happened, doesn't mean to say that this particular part of the coastline didn't suffer the attentions of the Luftwaffe and so on, because they did. The war, whether you are a civilian or whether you're a soldier on the coast, the war can kill you at any time without warning, and it does. But what's interesting is that in terms of the actual decisions on the ground and why you need defences, again, without buying into the myth of the Blitz, and so forth, there was a clear perception, it would seem, that the reason for the dislocation wasn't the troops on the ground themselves, it was the broader conflict. I mean, to put it in a very simple way, any objections to the privations of wartime were directed at the enemy. And this is a very good account from immediately after the war by this person, George Carter, was a pilot on the Thames, a river pilot, and he came back to Albury, which is where he grew up during the war when he was on leave, and he writes about it in these terms. I caught my breath, for Albury had had its share of the Luftwaffe's attentions. I had seen much bomb damage, but this seemed different. My loathing for the Hun became suddenly a very personal thing. A hate too great for my will to contain burst up inside me like a volcano. People had died here, staunch-hearted Albury folk who I'd known intimately, who had known me as a child. Alf, the friendly postman, who was never too busy to stop for a yarn, had been blinded. All the way up the street, the little shops against whose windows I'd pressed my nose as a child stood empty. Mere shells of brick remained, their walls pitted by cannon shell and machine gun bullets. A jeweller's shop that had once exhibited gorgeous fragments of seaborne amber and cornelian was merely a charred framework. And there's a sense in which, I think, as long as the military say they need those defences, they are tolerated. And they're tolerated for all those reasons I've been explaining in the second half of my paper. But the moment the war ends, it's very, very different. You read the town minutes at Albury, they are desperate for the beaches to be opened in the summer of 1945 because they desperately need the revenue to rebuild. And I often think of that. You know the film Jaws, where there's the town mayor? He knows there's a shark on the loose, but he's desperate. We've got to have the beaches open. We've got to have the beaches open because this is where we get our money from. You know, kind of reading the kind of town minutes of Albury, it's the same sort of thing. We've got to have the beaches open, we've got to have the beaches open, we need the money. But I think, lastly, for all of those reasons to do with a negotiation narrative rather than a contested one, there is a very, very brief period after the war where the presence of the coastal defences appears to be tolerated. It's almost as if they've become naturalised. And
This is best illustrated by Dunwich Beach. Now, this is a very famous spot on the East Anglian coast. It's where artists come and they come and do lots of nice paintings of the broad sweep of the coastline going north. Someone, in the late 1940s, we think, took that photograph of Dunwich Beach and then took the trouble, you can see, to artificially colour it and tint it. There was something, I don't know what, I can't explain it, but there was something about that scene which made it worthwhile photographing. Equally, you look at this Baldwin from 1953, I think it is, you can see some of the defences have gone, but there you can see that classic scene, the pillbox and the outer tank blocks are still there. And we've also got some great oral history from people saying, I can remember when the last remnants of the coastal defences were taken off the beach. We had one guy, he's referring to posts in the beaches to prevent landings by enemy planes. The post remained on the beach for some time after the war and became such a feature that when they were removed, the beach seemed to me to be curiously bald. It's quite interesting how they've sort of been, if you like, I don't know what the word is, still a work in progress, but naturalised whatever it kind of happens to be. But I'm told by my colleagues at UVA who study modern history that everything changed in the 1960s. Certainly from my point of view, studying this sort of stuff, it is indeed in the 60s where you start to get all kinds of letters to the local paper going, this pillbox is an obscene eyesore, it must be removed. So this brief period of toleration, I think, really is quite brief. But nonetheless, I think it's there. As I'm 1 minute over time of my 50 minutes, I will leave you with where I wanted to end. And I said that humour wasn't necessarily the sentiment in the summer of 1940. Wasn't strictly true, because you do in these sources get wonderful little things like this. This is from a battalion war diary of the 11th Highland Light Infantry from May 1941. And every week they have to go and exercise with the local Home Guard. One day a week they have to do that. And he's describing one exercise. Kangaroo exercise took place. It was directed against the Home Guard in the area and designed to test their efficiency. The Home Guard at least appeared to enjoy themselves, including two old warriors who lay behind a hedge, both over 60, and claimed to have put out of action one company, that's 120 men, two tanks, and a battalion of headquarters. It gets better. One of them was apparently used to a bottle of whiskey before breakfast. Thank you very much indeed for listening, ladies and gentlemen. I hope that was moderately interesting. Thank you.